you, Vanessa. Morning, church. I hope you're doing well. So I'm reading today's scripture, which comes from Acts 2, verse 42 to 47. So it reads, "They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were being performed through the apostles. Now all the believers were together and held all things in common. They sold their possessions and property and distributed the proceeds to all as any had need. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple and broke bread from house to house. They ate their food with joyful and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved." This is the reading of God's word.
Okay, good morning, fam. Really great to see you all. If we have not met, my name is Reino. I have the privilege of serving this church as pastor, and I have the privilege this morning of opening up the word with you, and I have the privilege of launching covenant commitment for the very first time in this church. I am very, very excited about it. Thank you to everyone who contributed to an amazing service this morning. I love worshiping with you. I love hearing from you. I love the fact that there's a buzz when we do question of the day. I love that last 5 minutes before the kids expire, before we release them. There's a really good vibe at Fellowship City at the moment. I love it, and I'm excited to see what the future holds for us. Now, I just said we are launching covenant commitment. Now, in my head, that's a really exciting thing because I know exactly what it means. You might not, so let me show you. What is covenant commitment? Read it with me with some highlights, a la Reino. It is an opportunity to commit to the vision of Fellowship City and to participate in the ministry of Fellowship City in a specific way for the next 12 months. That's covenant commitment. Starts today. I'll give you some dates in terms of how the next couple of weeks are going to go. We'll show you this definition probably every week, just to make sure that we're all on the same page. No one can qualify for this. Okay. There's no test being written. We are a grace-filled church. Look at the two words. It's an invitation to participation. What are we asking you to commit to? Read these five things with me. Firstly, supporting the vision of Fellowship City. Secondly, participating in the ministry, discipleship, and fellowship spaces of Fellowship City. Third, serving in the church through your time and talents. Four, giving treasures generously and consistently. Five, being accountable to your church family who are on this journey together. Invitation to participation. The invitation is to commit. These are the five things that we are asking you to commit to. You guys with me? Okay. So how are we going to do it? Over the course of the next 7 weeks, we will focus on one of the commitments we just read during our sermon. In the 7 weeks, we will use Acts 2, 42 to 47, that Mike just read for us, as an anchor text for the whole series. So that means every single week we'll read this text, and then we'll read this text and use it as a launching pad to focus on a specific theme for every week. I want to challenge you and also invite you to memorize Acts 2, 42 to 47 over the course of the next 7 weeks. Scripture memory, fam, it is an unbelievably powerful thing in terms of our spiritual formation. And then after these 7 weeks and during these 7 weeks, we are going to ask you for a commitment. How and when can I make my commitment? Commitments open on 2 June, and you will have time until 7 July to make your commitment. It opens up on the 2nd of June, and you'll have until the 7th of July. We'll communicate on all of our platforms, so may I ask you again, please do not archive the Fellowship City News Group. Don't do it. You can mute it if you want to, But don't archive it, because you're going to miss out. And that's our main means of communicating with you. So please read our messages. And if there's a link to click, please click the link if it's relevant to you. Your commitment will be your answer to the five commitments I just showed you. Does that make sense? You guys with me? Okay. Now, do you know what the vision of Fellowship City is? And do you know what it means to support this vision? My prayer and my mission today is that I will answer these questions as clearly as I possibly can. Let's pray before we jump in. Lord Jesus, we sung this morning about what you did for us. We sung this morning about what you are doing in us. All of that leaves us with a sense of awe and grace and love and peace and excitement, because you are on a journey with us. You've brought us together as brothers and sisters in you. You decided to plant Fellowship City. You've given it the life it has had up until this point. And Lord Jesus, we are excited and expectant about the future of the church. We're keen to hear from you this morning through your word. We know that this word is timeless, it's living, it can cut really deep. It's an amazing mirror for us to hold up this morning. May we see truth, may we see grace, may we hear the gospel, and may we leave here transformed, exactly like the people who we just read about. May your name be glorified in everything we do for the rest of this morning. We pray that in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Do you know what the vision of Fellowship City is? Let me show you. Read it with me. Seeing God's kingdom come by transformed lives in and through His transcultural church. Just to make sure that we read the text for all it is, I made you some highlights. Look at this one. God's kingdom, fam, is what it's all about. Transformed lives is what it's all about. And God's kingdom and transformed lives in and through is what it's all about. And not in and through random posts, in and through His transcultural church. A church that reflects, embraces, and enjoys the diversity of our context and by the power of the gospel transcends it. Let's move past these man-made boundaries to really become one new family in Christ. We worked hard on this vision, and we made sure that you can even read it backwards to make sure that it makes sense. So look, in and through His transcultural church, we want to see life transformed and see the kingdom come. Hey, 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 hey. That is our vision. How do we want to achieve this? We want to plant 10 churches of 250 people in this area. Why 250? Because we believe that the moment a church gets bigger than 250, you lose something of the intimacy and the relationship that we need to have. And also, because we are a transcultural church, it takes more effort to really get to know each other and to really get to love each other. So we want 2,500 people in the church, but then we'll lose something of that personal feel of the church. So 250 is max, and we want to plant 10. Why do we want to plant 10? Because we want to see 2,500 people in transcultural churches in this area. Why? Because this area has roughly between 15 and 30,000 people. So if we establish 10 churches and we have 250 people committed to this vision, we have more than 10% of this community in transcultural churches. And then we will change this community. Then we'll see the kingdom come through transformed lives, in and through His transcultural church. That's the vision, fam. We've done one. We've got 9 to go. Roughly, in Centurion, we have 250,000 people. So 2,500 people is 1% of the 250,000 people. Which means, with 1%, you can actually almost see a community transformation. And that's what we are dreaming about. Will we stop the day that we've planted our 10th one? Definitely not. But for now, this is the plan and the vision we have for our church going forward. 10 churches of 250. Now, if we put 250 people in this hall, we'll be full, which means that it's time for the next one, which is great. We've reached almost 100 people as regular Sunday attenders. It's much easier to get from 100 to 200 than it is to get from 30 to 100. Okay, so we worked hard for the first 2.5 years to get us to 100. Now we need to get to 250 so that the place can be full, so that we can plant the next one. I don't want you to get 100 more people. I want you to get one more. That's how it works. Think about it, fam. There's always space for one more. Not only in our church building, but one more in your life, and one more in God's kingdom. One more. I really love that language. One of our partner churches, Rooted Fellowship, also uses that language. Who is your one more? Who do you know that you can invite into this space? One of two categories of people. One, someone who does not know Jesus. That's why we're here. And the other one, someone who knows and loves Jesus, but for some reason are without a church and live in this area. Invite them to come. Who is your one more? If everyone brings a one more, all of a sudden we are at 200. So please, be empowered by the vision. Don't be anxious about the vision. Don't feel like it's too big for one person to achieve. It is way too big for one person to achieve. But we are all in this together. Do you know what it means to support this vision? Okay, so we've given you the vision in some really clear and concise words. Do you know what it means to support this vision? It means you live it. That's how you support this vision. You actually live what this vision says. You live a life centered on God's kingdom. You live a life that is constantly transforming into the image of Christ. You live a life in the church in terms of participation, community, and discipleship. And you also take up the calling that God has given you so that He can do something through you. Do you guys see it? Yeah, nice one, Reino. Good explanation, dude. It's a little bit abstract. Fair enough. We have a discipleship journey at Fellowship City. Because we don't want it to be abstract, we want it to be very, very practical. So to answer the question, how do I live a transformed life, we developed this triangle. Now some of you that have been with Fellowship City at least since September last year will be able to go through this triangle with me. How do I live a transformed life? Because I see the vision and I want to support the vision. Here's how you do it. You love God. And you love people. How do I love God and how do I love people? You know God. You commit faithfully. And you give generously. Nice one, Reino. How do I do that? A disciple knows God through his word, through encountering him, and through worship. A disciple commits faithfully to transformation, God's people inside the mission of the church. Outside. A disciple gives generously of time, talents, and treasures. If you want to support the vision of Fellowship City, you live it. If you want to live the vision of Fellowship City, this is how you do it. And see how it ties in with our vision statement. When you love God and love people, you see God's kingdom come. When you know Him, you commit faithfully and you give generously, you transform. When you commit faithfully to God's people, you do it in His transcultural church. When you commit faithfully to the mission of the church and when you give generously of your time, talents, and treasures, you also do it through His transcultural church. Do you guys see it? Are you excited about it? Fam, this is supposed to be really easy. No PhD needed for this. No A in grade 12 for English needed for this. This is something that needs to go from your brain and make its way down into your heart. And it has to settle there, and it has to take root there. Is this vision biblical? In proper South African English vernacular, let me answer you. It goes like this. 100%. 100%. Where do I get that? Well, let's go back to our teaching text. I made some highlights for you. Lots of highlights. I'm probably going to preach an hour and a half, so get comfortable. I'm joking. I won't. I won't. Relax. Relax. Let's work through the highlights. There was a devotion. There was teaching. There was fellowship. There was communion. There was prayer. There was awe. There were signs and wonders. People were together. People shared. It wasn't only sharing hard stuff. It was sharing real stuff, possessions and property. It was distributed to all as they had need. There was a rhythm to their devotion. Every day they did something, and it transformed them. They had joyful and sincere hearts. They lived lives of worship. A disciple knows God through worship. Praising God, enjoying the favor of all people. And every day the Lord added to their number. Fam, the only reason we have for wanting to grow the numbers of this church and wanting to plant more churches is because God adds people to our number every day who are being saved. Do you guys realize that? Like the goal of 10 times 250 has got nothing to do with bragging rights. To say, hey, Fellowship City has 2,500 people in worship every Sunday. There's space for more, you know. And God will keep on adding to His church. Especially if His church lives in this way. Okay, so vision is biblical. Check. The triangle is biblical. Check. How are you doing? How are you doing? Does your life reflect this vision? Let's do some personal deep work here. Does your life reflect this vision? Well, let me ask you a simpler question. Are you living a transforming and transformed life? And just before you're tempted to say 100%, what if I would ask the person who knows you best? That's probably the best mirror we have, right? I'm married to Marie. So if you want to know if I'm living a transforming and transformed life, I can keep you busy with stories for days. Ask her. So what if I would ask the person who knows you best? What is the answer to this question? Now, because we'll be in this text for the next 7 weeks, let me do an overview of the text this morning. And then we'll dive deeper into it in the weeks to come. I want to use an illustration of diet and exercise to explain something about devotion. Is that fine for you? Why do I want to do that? Because our teaching text starts with, they devoted themselves. So let me use an illustration of diet and exercise. You guys know me as a runner. I still am. I was out this morning and it was freezing and awesome, both at the same time. You guys might not know that there was a time when I was a cyclist. I've got proof. Here's a photo for you. This is myself on the Transbavians mountain bike race. In the background, you'll see my dad. I just left him behind a little bit on that specific hill, but it's a race in which we participated together as a team. Solid bucket list item. I always wanted to do an endurance event with my dad. And when we had the opportunity to do it on a bicycle, I literally had to become a cyclist. So I had to leave running. I had to turn. And I had to devote myself to this thing called cycling. Fam, it's completely different than running. I had to get a bicycle first. Let me start there. I had to get whole new kit. A running short on a bicycle will not work. I had to find new mates to train with. I had to change my diet I had to change my training times. I had to change my training length. I had to change the whole way that I trained. I had to change around pretty much my whole life routine. I had to learn a whole new language. I had no idea what a one by or a two by was. I had no idea what pressure was in the shocks of the bicycle. I had no idea what the width of tires were. I had no idea what Strava was. True story, even though I am a runner. I had to learn a whole new language. And then I had to do this over and over and over again. And to prepare for this race, my dad and I did 5,500 kilometers of training. And then I pitched up at that race and I was like, my word, I have become a cyclist. I can do it, man. I know the language. I'm fit. I'm ready. I've got all the kit. Let's go. And we completed the race. I'm using that as an illustration to illustrate what the word devoted means. We think of devotions, especially in the church culture, as myself with a cup of steaming coffee, with some William Augusto background music, reading the Psalms with my cool typo pen, making marks, taking pictures of it and posting it on my story. You know what I mean? I never do that. I've never had a story. I actually don't know how it works. I'm just using language that you guys might understand. We think that's devotion. That's not devotion. Devotion means committing to something over and over because you know it's good for you. My cycling metaphor might not have landed with all of you. Fair enough. Let me use an easier one. How about brushing your teeth? You brush your teeth, and I hope you did, because you believe it's good for you. And sometimes you don't even think about it. I mean, none of us stand in front of the mirror and go, what's the rhyme again? Alu in die ronde, alu in die ronde. You know what I mean? You don't stand in front of the mirror and think about brushing your teeth. You know exactly where to start, how to do it, what angles to take, and also when your mouth is all filled up with foam, you know it's time to finish. It comes naturally. Why? Because you've done it a gazillion times. All of us who have raised kids, do you guys remember how difficult it was for a kid to brush their teeth in the beginning? My word, toothpaste everywhere except in their mouths. But they got going and they repeated and they repeated and they repeated. And now we are all teeth brushing adults. Toothbrushing adults. Teeth brushing adults. I don't know what the right word is. Your devotion, your commitment to doing something over and over shows what you prioritize. Period. You'll be devoted to the things that you actually think are important. And this teaching text tells us what the first church were devoted to. If we want to use the earlier illustration, we can say it was a snapshot of the diet and the training program of the early church. Now, here's what they devoted themselves to. Let me show you 4 points. I'm going to move through them quickly because we're definitely going to get back to it in the weeks to come. The church in Acts devoted themselves to biblical nourishment, loving fellowship, vibrant worship, and word and deed outreach. Our theme for today is supporting the vision. Now, if you support the vision of Fellowship City, then you know how important those priorities are, and you will also live it. The reason why I had you guys answer questions about subscriptions during Question of the Day is because we live in a world where you can subscribe to something, and you can pay for it, and you don't care about it. It's quite sad now, isn't it? Part of Vanessa's sharing was, I just didn't want to pay for stuff that I don't care about anymore. Because the stuff that I pay for, I am supposed to care about. I think it's the same with the church. I think you can say you're all in for the vision, but you actually don't care. And you also don't prioritize anything about the vision. And that's why we're going to take a deep dive into these devotions of the church over the next few weeks. Biblical nourishment, loving fellowship, vibrant worship, word and deed outreach. Let's tackle each one. We'll do it quickly. Go with me. First one, biblical nourishment. So they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Let's pause there. They gathered. Do you guys see that? We see in verse 46 that they also gathered in the temple. We see that they also gathered in homes. Obviously, they were a big community, broken into a whole lot of smaller communities. But this is a learning community. It's a community that says, someone needs to teach me something and I cannot get enough of it. It's a distinctive mark of this community. Why is it first? Well, because what they are learning is about who they are worshiping. So, Famke, can I just ask you a question? Do you actually catch up on a sermon if you missed it? I don't want you to catch up on a sermon if you missed it because I worked hard on the sermon. I want you to catch up on it because you ought to be hungry. If you missed the sermon, you're supposed to go, my word, why am I so hungry? Because I didn't hear any of the apostles' teaching from someone appointed by God to teach me these things. And how will I know who I'm going to worship if I never listen to who I am worshiping? That's what we teach. I don't teach you self-help at this church. I don't teach you stuff that doesn't matter about Hebrew punctuation marks in poetry. It's really cool for the Bible nerds in the place. But I teach you things that will help you to understand who are you worshiping. So does Lesego, so does Shiami, so does Peter, and so does every other person who ever stands on this stage and preaches. You ought to feel hungry if you missed it, because you're malnourished. I know from our viewing statistics and our download statistics that our people don't catch up on their sermons. And I want to call you back to it. That's the reason why we put it out there, right? So that you can go, even though I was not there this Sunday, I feel really hungry. I'm going to get to it first thing on Monday morning. Biblical nourishment. Okay, now, what are the apostles teaching? And how is that different from the gospel? I think this is important. So remember what Peter did earlier in the chapter of Acts 2. Peter preached the gospel. He told the story of Jesus, and he told the people what it means. And what he said was, now that Jesus is resurrected from the dead, now that he's ascended to heaven, and now that he's poured out his spirit over all believers, you now have the opportunity to become a new human. Do you want to be a new human? And the Bible says in verse 41, about 3,000 people were added to them, saying, yes, 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 I want to be a new human. How does that work? That's the apostles' teaching. Do you see the difference? So the gospel message is that God himself became a human in Jesus Christ and reversed the curse of Genesis 3. He fixed everything that sin broke, and then he removed the division between God and his people, and through grace, through faith in Jesus, you be reconciled with the Father. He lives in you through his Holy Spirit. And then this beautiful process of transformation happens. Then you have the opportunity to become a new human. That's the gospel. We share the gospel every week during our sermons because some of you might not have heard it in such a clear way, or some of you might have heard it a gazillion times, but you've never said, play me. I want to become a new human. It's a step of faith, fam. Here's how it works. God gives you the gift of faith, and then you take a grip on it by doing a leap of faith. And you say, I trust, I put my full weight in the truth that Jesus died for my sins. He's my Lord, he's my Savior, and I now surrender my whole life to him. And then you come back, week after week, to sit under the apostles' teaching, to figure out what this life looks like, and how it works. So the apostles' teaching is to explore all of these implications of this phenomenal announcement of the good news. Now remember, I preach to you from the Bible, from the New Testament, printed in English nogal. Can you believe it? They didn't have the New Testament at that point. As they were speaking these words, the New Testament came into existence. So the actual apostles say to the people, here's what Jesus said to us. This is what we see him do, what we saw him do, and this is what he commanded us to do. Now the question is, if all of this is true, how should we then live? Because we can tell you that Jesus was raised from the dead, so he's Lord of all, so now we obey him. Let's figure out what that means. That required a daily devotion and a lifetime commitment. Fam, a lifetime commitment. If you ever make the mistake to think that you can go without biblical nourishment, you will either be on a really serious spiritual plateau, or your life will just start drying out and dying spiritually. It's a lifelong devotion. I spent 6 years studying the Bible over the course of 2 degrees. I can read Hebrew and I can read Greek and I can pass these words out. I still don't know everything about the Bible. I learn something new every single day as I read it. I can't get enough of it. And once I'm done, I start again and I choose a new translation and I just go for it. Every single day, we ought to read it. On Friday, I celebrated 19 years of commitment to Jesus. It's always a great day for me, the 17th of May, and I thought back of where I was and where I am now. The most consistent thing over the last 19 years was His Spirit inside of me and His Word. That's it. And for 19 years, I've been reading this book, and I'm still reading it. I read it this morning because I have to. I listened to a sermon this morning while I ran about parenting from a guy in San Francisco because I also need to sit under the apostles' teaching. I knew that I was going to preach this morning, but it's not like I can bank on my own sermon to feed me, you know. So I had someone else feed me after I read my scripture this morning, and then I came to church full. That's why I can keep going so long. I'm joking. Daily devotion. What are you consuming? Because, let me just say it on this side, if it's not the Word, something else is going to be pumped into your head and into your ears. If you're reading more news and scrolling more socials and listening to more radio than you are in the Word, don't be surprised that something else is profoundly shaping you. Because that'll shape you. Our kids always ask me when we drive to work, to school. They say, Dad, why don't you listen to the radio? And I said to them, because I need to think of the things that I read in the Bible this morning now. I can't allow something else to enter my head. Like, I'll chill with you guys. You can ask me anything. But I can't have something else dominate my thoughts at 7 in the morning. I can't. Because I read scripture, I listened to a sermon while I ran, now I need to let that come to fruition in my life. I'll read news at lunch when I'm ready for it. But until then, it's the gospel, it's the book of Acts, it's Paul on his way to Rome, that's where I'm at now. And his commitment, and how he heralds the gospel, and how he persuades people, and how persecuted he was, and how uncertain he was, and how the religious, you see what I mean? That's where my head's at. I can't hear news now, can't. Where are you? And what do you consume? Let's look at the second one. Loving fellowship. Loving fellowship, the word used in this text, is koinonia. It's more than just getting together. It's a commitment to share everything with other people. It's a move from proximity to compassion. It's a move from us versus them to just us. Fam, how do you get to know someone? You have to spend time with them. You have to listen to them. And then you start sharing something of yourself with them as trust builds, as vulnerability grows. Can anyone in this church tell me if that happens over the course of 5 minutes or possibly 5 years, It's always longer. Building relationships takes effort and it takes ages. But if you devote yourself to it, you'll see it happen. Lesego will tackle all of our discipleship spaces in a few weeks' time. Fam, do you know why you pitch for a discipleship group? Do you know why you pitch for a city group? You pitch because that's the only way that you're going to get to know these people better. It's just how it is. And devoting yourself to it means I'll do it repeatedly, even if I don't feel like it, because I know that it's good for me. They devoted themselves to it. We ought to devote ourselves to it. It takes intentionality. And especially in a church like ours, where we speak multiple different languages and we represent multiple different people groups, sometimes you're not quite sure what to talk about. That's okay. Try something. And if it flops, try something else. Try having a conversation until something happens, until there's a resonance, until there's a shared humanity, until we get to know each other a little bit better. You guys might have noticed, we are 2.5 years old. We still give name tags. Why? To make connection even easier. Because you might go, I've seen that person here for 12 months now, but I still can't remember their names. That's okay. You're a human being. You're not AI. But we give name tags so that you can approach someone and go, hello, te piso. How are you? No shame. I still wear this bad boy. And I introduce myself every week so that you feel a comfortability in walking up to me and going, hey, Reino, what's up? Then I'll go, what's up? And then we'll have koinonia, loving fellowship. I have said this before, but let me say it again. If you are a ninja Christian, no one will ever know you, and you'll never know anyone. Ninja Christians are people who come after the service has started and they leave before the service has ended. Don't do it. Because you're just going to be alone and isolated, and you're going to see a whole lot of other people have fun. We are called to be devoted to loving fellowship. Third one, vibrant worship. Look at the teaching text, verse 42. They devoted themselves to prayer. This was a group of people who were used to praying specific prayers at specific times. This was a group of people that were used to praying through the Psalms, reading through the Psalms, and singing through the Psalms. And this was a group of people that we're used to getting together doing it. Question. Are you currently enjoying prayer? Are you enjoying prayer? You know what the word enjoy means. And you know what the word prayer is. Can you put them together in the same sentence and say, at the moment, I love it. I enjoy speaking to God. When I do speak to Him, I get filled with this feeling that I get to do this. It fills me with awe. It fills me with joy. It fills me with wonder. I can't believe that I'm speaking to the creator of the universe, the guy that let the orange ball rise this morning over the eastern horizon, the one who sent His Son 2,000 years ago to die for me. The one who's given me everything that I have. I think, was it Jake who read this morning, in Him we move and live and have our being. I can't believe that I get to speak to Him without jumping any hurdles or any loops. Is that where you are? Because the text says to us that they were filled with awe. They were filled with wonder. And they praised God every day because of it. In stock standard South African English, we would say it never got old. Never got old to them. Has it gotten old to you? Because if it does, the vibrancy of your relationship will very, very steadily decline. Let me ask it another way. If someone looks at your life and we ask that someone, can you see that this person believes in good news of great joy? What would they say? Because remember, our lives are supposed to convince people. Like our worship are supposed to convince people when we are together and when we are alone. There's nothing worse for me personally when we stand in this building and we sing Malibongwe and the look on your face is Malibongwe, Malibongwe. Like if I could pause you, I would ask, what are you currently doing? Because you're saying your name be praised, but I don't know who you're singing to. And it also doesn't look like you're enjoying it. Have you ever looked at people in a restaurant? Huh? Sorry, what were you saying? Yeah, I'm going to get the schnitzel. What would you say? Are they having fun? Would you look at them and go, "Woo! Hashtag life goals. I want to be exactly like those people." You're not. That's why the church ought to be known for vibrant worship. That's how we convince people that this thing we believe in is actually real. It's part of sharing the good news. If you start talking about Jesus, smile, fam. Because it's a joyful message that you're sharing with someone. I usually just start crying. But it's because I'm a sissy. If you're a growing Christian, and Malibongwe doesn't necessarily tug on your heartstrings yet, just keep going. Keep going. Keep repeating. Keep repeating. Stay devoted. You'll see. Your understanding of what we're busy with here grows and grows and grows how we go. These things, vibrant worship and prayers, they remake our minds. They remake our lives. And we learn how to respond to Jesus. This morning was one of those mornings where I could have gone for an hour and a half. It's just how it is. Worship was, the tempo was just brilliant. It led me into this really, really deep place. And when Vanessa said, thank you so much, I was like, oh, are we done? It's one of those mornings I could have just gone on and on and on. That's what makes Encounter Worship so awesome. You'll hear more about that in the weeks to come. It's just an open space for worship. Last one, word and deed outreach. Word and deed outreach. This group of people, this devoted group of people, said, we'll take the word everywhere we go, and we'll show the word everywhere we go. Do you guys see it? Oh, here's a little rhyme. Go and show. How's that? For a little sending charge. So this church spoke everywhere they went and invited people into this new community and told them the good news of Jesus, and they reinforced this word that they spoke because of the way that they lived. And then the way that they lived showed that what they shared was actually real. Think about this. God loves me so much that it's completely changed the way I now love other people. Phenomenal testimony, Reino. Beautiful. Do you mind showing me what that looks like? See, and that's what the early church did, is they then lived in a way where someone would trace your steps and go, my word, they are really different. I don't know if you guys watch The Chosen. We do as a family. It's really great. And the cool thing about The Chosen for us as a family at the moment is to see how the characters develop and to see how the characters change and to see how someone who was like this, now all of a sudden is like this. And especially the love between the disciples and the struggles they have with each other. It's beautiful to behold. We love it. Season 3, episode 3 at the moment. Let's go, Myers. The way you live becomes a testimony of the thing that you just shared and that you believe in. The way that we will keep on adding one more to this church is if you would say to someone, come and see. Just come and see. I've shared with you now the good news. I've told you about our church even. I've told you what Jesus means to me and how that has changed my life. Can I ask you to just come and see? We do have many people who come and see. 100% of people who come and see says, wow, this is awesome. And then 60% never come back. Because they say it's a little bit too threatening. Like people talk to you. It's very long. We actually just want to pull in and pull out. And then I go, you know what? That's all good. Luckily, praise God, there's about 19 churches in Centurion that could feed you. So go for that. But the 40% that stay, like stay. Because they came, they saw, and then they go, my word, this is something that resonates with my heart, and I'm being fed here, and I'm having loving community here, and I see vibrant worship here, and I see word and deed outreach between these people. Sign me up, I'm in. That's how we grew to the number where we are at the moment. So this church showed compassion to people inside the church and to people outside the church. And we need to do both, and we want to do both. That's an overview of this teaching text. For the next 6 weeks, we'll drill deeper into these. Will you support this vision? If you want to support this vision, start with these four things: biblical nourishment, loving fellowship, vibrant worship, word and deed outreach. Amen. I want to show you the triangle again. So Lesego, if I could have the triangle, that'll be phenomenal. And also, if we could send a signal to Jake and to Harmony. Mpodumo is already here, and Riven is at teens. I'll be really glad, because we are on our way to land. Guys, you are going to see the triangle every time. Why? Because it's a practical way of deciding what your next step is. So we spoke about biblical nourishment. Maybe your next step is to say, God, I want to know you through your word. And that's where I'm going to start. Maybe your next step is, God, I want to know you through encountering you and through worship. So I will submit myself under the Sunday word and I'll commit to Sundays. That's another way of doing it. You might read Bible every day, but you actually don't follow along as the Bible gets expounded and explained. We spoke about loving fellowship. Maybe your next step is to say, God, I want to commit faithfully to your people. So please, show me the people, or give me the people. Fam, many people in this church would tell you this story. I was really afraid to commit, but once I did, it was awesome. I understand not everyone is extreme extroverts like me. You know, sometimes I've got a lot of compassion on myself because I'm really weird. And then I have more compassion on Marie because she decided to marry me. I could talk to people 24 hours a day, the whole day. Love it. Always space for one more. My heart is like a Pretoria taxi. I'll make space. Pull through. In a good way, that is. Not everyone is like that. Some of you might feel real anxiety even sitting in this building. That's okay. Ask God then for the people of peace. Ask God to give you the right people to commit to in a discipleship space. We spoke about vibrant worship. Maybe that's something that you feel needs to be developed. Maybe your next step is to say, God, I want to know you through worship. So when we are together, when we sing, when someone in the worship ministry does a call to worship, change my heart, change my focus, take control of my imagination. Teach me how to do this. We also spoke about word and deed outreach. Maybe your next step is to say, and check this, one more. God, please help me to have one gospel conversation this week. One. Not 200. One. I want to talk to someone about you this week. Will you please grant me the grace, the wisdom, the power, and the know-how to do it just once? The mission of the church. Or maybe deed outreach means giving some of your time and serving somewhere. Or using the talents you have for the flourishing of others. Or actually giving money towards something or someone that is a deed connected to your conviction. Do you guys see how we work with the triangle? Do you guys see it? You look at it and you ask the Spirit to give you the space and the understanding of what it is that He wants you to do next. That's all we're asking you to do. And today starts by saying, I want to support this vision, which means I want to live this life, which means that the Spirit will tell me what my next step is. And then I'm going to be faithful in doing it. Let's close our eyes and pray. Lord Jesus, stir in us a love for your word, because we want to be nourished by it. Stir in us a devotion to it. Meet us as we read it, as we listen to it, as we repeat it, and as we sing it. Lord Jesus, stir in us a love for one another, that we will truly love each other like brothers and sisters, that we will love each other like you loved us, that we would be a loving and a welcoming community to all people. Stir in us a hunger for worship. Fill us with awe. Fill us with joy. Fill us with praise like you did the early church. May it never get old, Lord Jesus. We want to worship you with everything inside of us, mind and heart. Lord, give us the opportunity to speak about you. Give us the opportunity to show your love. Give us the wisdom and discernment to know when it's go time. And then help us to do it faithfully. This is your church, Lord Jesus. Have your way in us, we pray. Amen.